Good afternoon and welcome to Talks at GS. I'm Cliff Marriott. I am the co-head of our TMT advisory group in Europe at Goldman. And I'm very excited and pleased to have Niklas Zennström, founder of Skype and founder of Atomico, amongst other things we'll get into here today. Niklas is a serial entrepreneur, having co-founded several successful technology companies, most notably Skype in the early 2000s. Yeah. In 2006, he founded Atomico with an aim to invest and support entrepreneurs outside Silicon Valley that had, until then, had limited access to funding. Can you run us through your background and how you ended up where you are?
Sure. So I was growing up in Sweden and in a university town north of Stockholm. And you know, back then when I was studying computer science, engineering, it was hard to know that what is Silicon Valley, what is like, you know, we know about, you know, Microsoft and we know about IBM and when I was at high school, you know, the Apple Macintosh came out, that was amazing. But I didn't really understand what entrepreneurs was. What was an entrepreneur? It's like, because it didn't exist, the whole concept of venture capital and startup companies. And you know, you couldn't Google it because there was no internet. So, certainly was no web browser back then. So, it was like a mystery. But I always felt when I was going to school that at some point I want to be starting my own company. And I was fascinated by network and computer science. And although I realized I was never the really good programmer, but I wanted to apply tech in business. So I got off working for a very successful Swedish entrepreneurial company called the Kinnevik Group for the late Jan Stenbeck. But it wasn't kind of typical startup because he had inherited this conglomerate and transformed it to telecoms. But that, at least I learned how to be entrepreneurs. And that was at a time in the 90s, this was where actually a lot of successful Swedish entrepreneurs worked in this company and in this group. But in the dot-com era, in 99, I was kind of working this company, providing ISP services. I got the task to run this web portal in 99. So that was kind of how, that was like my first real, kind of now I'm the CEO, but I was working for a group. And it was, of course, challenged with a lot of politics and everything. But I learned so much there. And one of the key things that connection I got was we set up our engineering team in Estonia, and that's where I got to know some amazing engineers who then started to work with me and my co-founder when we started, not Skype, but we started Casa. So in February 2000, I resigned, and kind of just about before the dot-com crash started, that's when we started like our entrepreneurial journey. But you know, what we told each other was like, oh, this is like we missed the boat. Of course, that's what we thought. But then it's like,
When it crashed in
March 2000.
It's like
we were too late. Exactly, we should have done this. Like, now it's like, that was a lifetime opportunity. It's like, how could this happen? I missed it. It was right in front of me. That was my chance. My friends were, you know, they were working in investment banking, made some good money. It's like, this was my opportunity. That was it, that was the window. But back then, it's like, it was impossible to raise money. So like, we went around to raise money here in Europe and of course it was because so many people who had invested in dot-com era had burnt themselves. Here in Europe, I think most investors literally thought, well, that didn't work. Let's go back to what we know.
Yeah.
I think the difference in Silicon Valley was that the investors there had gone through different cycles. Yeah. And they knew that they had a conviction that tech is the future.
So then on to Skype. Yeah. Where did the idea for Skype come from and how did you?
So 2002 this was, and when I was traveling around in Europe primarily, I was so frustrated by the telecom companies that they were charging so much for roaming, and specifically with mobile data, I don't know how much more, but it was like ridiculous. So I was using different, you know, SIM cards, the prepaid SIM cards used because it was cheaper. At the same time, you know, we had proliferation of broadband, Wi-Fi, and you had these PDAs, you know, before the BlackBerry, like the
Palm Pilot.
Palm Pilots, and the Microsoft was actually leading there with the Microsoft Windows Mobile. And they had Wi-Fi, so we kind of thought that, gee, what if we put voice over IP software on these PDAs, use Wi-Fi, and then somehow connect a unified Wi-Fi network, we can then bypass the global telecom services and provide a free global telephone service. That could be big, that could be very disruptive. We were super excited about it. And we thought we can raise money, and of course, it was impossible. But this time was also, I think it were two things. One was that it was very disruptive and very ambitious. So the European VCs like, well, we haven't seen this in the US, so why do you want to do this? Why don't you do something that works in the US and apply it here in a local market? So the VCs back then in Europe, most of them were had limited ambition. And the American VCs said, like, why don't you come to Silicon Valley, which we didn't want to do. So it kind of started out from kind of seeing a problem, experiencing a problem ourselves, being really frustrated with that problem, and then kind of realizing, how can we solve this problem?
And then people can read about how you sold the company to eBay and then actually bought it back and then eventually sold it to Microsoft.
Yeah.
So in 2006, after the first sale, you started Atomico to invest in European and let's say global tech. Yeah. Where do you think we are now relative to where you started, where we were when you started in 2006?
So when we started Atomico in 2006, it was really kind of a direct consequence of my experience as an entrepreneur here, where I was so frustrated. So everything I'm saying, I don't know how many times I say this, I'm frustrated, but that's probably good. That's probably a lot of entrepreneurs were, or that's how they start things. No, but it was annoying that we didn't really have a VC community here. And everyone thought, well, you had to be in Silicon Valley. And it's probably right that you had to be in Silicon Valley because there was an ecosystem. And I think we were maybe lucky, we were doing the right thing at the right time and so forth. And so we became an outlier, we became a breakout company. Well, what I knew and what I had strong confidence about was that we have so much talent in Europe, back then also, so much talent in Europe. But there's no lack of talent. There's no lack of computer science engineers. There's an amazing infrastructure. It's a really good regulatory framework and so forth. So there is no reason why we shouldn't be able to create a lot of successful companies. Kind of jokingly, what we said, well, if we can be successful with Skype, you know, clearly a lot of others will be successful because we knew there's many sharp people out there. So that was the vision that then we said great companies will come from everywhere, but our focus was Europe, and I felt compelled to be part of building that European tech ecosystem.
What, I mean, maybe two questions which maybe have the same answer. What area of tech are you most excited about as an investor, and what area are you most passionate about as a human being?
Yes, good. Yeah, maybe the same. In that kind of earlier wave, certainly we participated in companies like Spotify, King, Supercell, was very much about consumer. And I think that kind of the mobile, when the smartphone came out with iPhone and the App Store, it was very much about that consumer wave. And what we've seen in the last few years is that it's a much more shift towards enterprise companies. And I think, so in that kind of, that the last kind of 10, 15 years, it was more about doing things online. I think what happened now we have the infrastructure in place everywhere almost globally. And now companies are not, before companies were building kind of tech, there were tech companies building tech services and tech solutions. Now you have companies addressing mobility, they're addressing kind of, you know, how to stay in a hotel, they're addressing how to get food, and then we see a lot of companies, so they're addressing other problems than tech. And this was interesting because that market's so much bigger. It's like so much, you know, before, like if you even think about Google and Facebook, these companies are advertisement-based businesses.
Yeah.
It's not a very big market. So if you think about healthcare, if you think about mobility, transportation, these are some really, really big sectors that you're starting to nudge. I mean, and where technology can have a real impact as well. So because of these new type of companies are addressing non-tech problems, some of them are also addressing, so that's what's exciting because the opportunities are bigger, but it's also harder, but because there's so much infrastructure in place now that you can do these things.
Yeah.
And funding, by the way, because these companies are requiring more and more funding as well, so it's important that these capital markets and there's appetite from investors. What I'm personally most excited about is these companies are addressing non-tech problems that are also kind of fundamental challenges to our society. And so the biggest challenge we have is climate. If we don't fix climate in the next 10 years, we have a really, really, that's probably past the point of no return.
And you think it's that quick?
I think that's what I hear from scientists is like the next 10 years. Because you're getting into kind of some certain kind of tipping points where ecosystems, environmental ecosystems are breaking down. But we need, and today we don't have the leadership from politicians to deal with their kind of engaged with other things. So I think the great entrepreneurs, they're seeing problems and they see challenges and they see opportunities and think, what are the tech solutions we can use to address these problems? But the other, but then you also have consumers. If you look at millennials and Gen Z, they are actually caring so much more than my generation about purpose, where they work. They want to work for companies which have a real purpose, but also care about products and services they're buying. They want to buy products and services where the supply chain is done in a sustainable, environmentally and social way. So companies that are being built today by founders are addressing some of these problems, or they realize that if I build a company that is fixing or addressing some of these big challenges, I can recruit the best people and I can have a competitive advantage in terms of a brand position.
And save the world.
And save the world at the same time. So that's what we see now, so that's what I'm most excited about. And I think it's a great opportunity, but it's also, but it's not about like, well, maybe they're not going to be so successful. I think that those are the companies going to be even more successful. So it's not about like, well, these are companies which are addressing environmental problems, but they're not, it's like a double bottom line. No, there are those as well, a lot of those, but the big opportunities are the ones that are actually great commercial companies.
That's right. So the responsibility that comes with, and you talked about already that you've kind of, part of Atomico is actually giving back because you were so fortunate to have such a great outcome with Skype. Tech is now garnering more scrutiny. Obviously, we've seen what's happened with Facebook and others. There's probably more of that to come, I would imagine. What are you doing specifically in terms of how you're investing or how you're motivating your teams or the portfolio companies to address some of those social issues and do good out of
tech? Yes. That's a very important question. So I think there's two sides of this. This is the thing that I talked about just now is like how the positive impact of tech, and that's something that I've been passionate about for many years. And just a few, and I think most of us, including myself, we're kind of had a blind spot about the negative impact because I remember back even then when I was doing this internet service, in Tele2 in the late 90s, like the internet is like, what is really the traffic there? It's like there's some people using it for illegal stuff, and there's like
the obvious things.
And it's like, yes, and all these new furious use cases, and is it internet really good? It's like, of course it's good. It's like we're connecting the world. It's like always connecting is always better, which in a way I still think it is. However, we've been kind of been very sobering the last few years. It's like, but we have to ask ourselves, yes, it is, good connect, but because of this network becomes more and more powerful, these negative consequences can be really, really big.
Yeah.
And I think that we have been living in a bubble, everyone in tech, because we don't even question this, that is so powerful, that is all the positive impacts, that is only positive. And that is something that I think has been really good that we have this dialogue the last 2 years that actually there are also this really, really severe negative impact. And because the internet now is you know, 10 times bigger than it was, you know, a few years ago and so forth. So we need to seriously consider this. And so what we do when we have, and everybody realizes as we have a responsibility, I think we have a responsibility as an investor, because when these startup companies, they're, you know, there might be as few as, you know, 10 people when we invest, sometimes 50, but they're still small companies, and they're trying to use, kind of trying to find some product market fit. And when they meet investors, they think that they need to talk about how to make money. Of course, that's what we want to talk about, but we also provide governance. So typically when a VC comes in, it's the first time when they get a proper board. And so one of the things that we're taking on ourselves is also to talk about, you know, ethics. What are the kind of ethical implications of what you do? And one thing that we started to do just recently is kind of to have a dialogue with founders, like if you scale your company and your company is going to be winning a category, what are the potential negative implications that it can have if things are, if your model is being optimized, what are the negative consequences and who are those kind of different stakeholders who may not be at the table?
Yeah.
And that's a really interesting exercise. And pretty much all the founders that we talk with, that they think this is really, really interesting. And then you can start talking about what are the things you can do already now in your company to mitigate some of those things. And it can be to maybe build some very strong culture. It can be to maybe write down some kind of principles that companies should live by. By doing these things, they can also build a stronger, lasting culture. So that's kind of one other thing. So we also, when we do this also, we kind of become much more careful investing in companies where, when the business model being optimized, if it has really, if it kind of exploits people or if it resources. And the other thing that is a big problem is diversity and inclusion.
Yeah, I was going to ask about that. Yeah. Almost every conversation I have with a venture capitalist talks about this issue in terms of their people, but also the companies in which they invest. How are you addressing that?
So the first thing is like now, when even for us like a year and a half ago, it's like, can we talk about this? Because we haven't been that great ourselves. And if we look around in an industry.
You're better than most, though.
Maybe we have, but it's like we don't have the parity. When we look back into like in our portfolio companies, how many female founders, it's not like amazing. We've been better than the market, but still it's not great. But then we started to think about systematic, what are the things that we can do, and started doing things before we talked about it. So a few things that we did was, what we realized that it's very intimidating for a founder to come and pitch to a VC investor, because it's like it's a pretty important moment for them to build a company, and it's a kind of a power situation. So if these VC partners are all white men and you are a woman, it's going to be more intimidating. So one thing that we realize is super important is that we also have a lot of female investors, because it happens much more organically that female investors are finding female founders, and female founders are much more comfortable speaking to female investors. So that's one thing to just make sure to hire, really focus on hiring more female investors. And the other thing we're doing is, so that's on the founder side and on our side. But then you also need to look at diversity in the teams of companies. And it's really hard when a company becomes like over 100 or 200 people to kind of to fix the diversity problem. And typically, I think what a lot of companies have done, when they're small, they get some funding, it's about you need to scale. You certainly have no HR person. So you're trying to find people who you know. And if you're a bunch of guys, you're very likely to hire more guys because those are the people you can in your network. And you need someone to come and help develop the product. And after a short while, if you're 50 people and most of them are men, it's going to be extremely intimidating for the first female engineer to join that team or non-engineer. So front-loading this issue much earlier and trying to help companies as soon as possible to hire females, and is, I think it's also one way to to help to fix that balance. But for I think for us, it's just kind of not only to bring this up with founders and really talk about it and also help them in a systematic way. So what we did end of last year, we published this a toolkit, a guidebook with Diversity VC, and how to kind of work with improve your diversity.
I really want to thank you for the candid discussion. Thank you for coming in. Really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.